Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to Terryville Congregational Church. Beautiful day, beautiful past couple weeks we've had. What a stretch of beautiful weather. We're glad you're here. We're here to worship God. And I want to tell you right as we get started that after church today, there's no coffee hour here because we have a town-wide picnic that's happening on the Plymouth Green. So all you got to do is go down this road out here, head that way, and get over to the Plymouth Congregational Church. And right outdoors there on their front lawn on the green, we've got hot dogs, hamburgers, and all kinds of food. And we hope a lot of you can come because we have a lot of food. So just head right over. I'm going to change clothes quickly after church and head over myself. And there'll be a few of us getting those grills going, and we'll have a good time together. So we're really looking forward to this event because we have Catholic friends coming, we have Lutheran friends coming, we have Baptist friends coming, and we have, of course, the congregational churches. So hopefully we'll get a good turnout, perfect day for it. So we're glad you're here. I'll have Peggy introduce herself, and then we'll take announcements.
Good morning. My name is Peggy Winnesky, and I'm your lay reader today. Do we have any announcements, prayer requests, or celebrations?
I'm going to start us off this morning because we have a special guest with us. We have with us this morning our regional minister, Reverend Isaac Lawson, and I'm so glad he's joining us. You may be wondering, what is that? We don't see our regional ministers too often because they are oftentimes busy dealing with churches that are going through transitions, like if a church is looking for a new minister, don't worry, it's not happening here. Or if a church is having problems, they come in and help. They help with new students that are going into ministry, people that are just starting a ministry and are being ordained. And some of you know this. I am now on a committee that helps with our region, and we do a lot of things in the region in addition to the things I just mentioned, like we did the mission trip this past summer. That was not just for our church, it was actually for the whole region. We also have this church coach, he's called coach or consultant, that is also working with our entire region. And so it's one of those things where a lot of times if a church has needs, Isaac is busy helping with those needs. We are considered a somewhat normal or healthy, so we don't see him too much, but he is making the time in the midst of all his busyness to be here with us because he wants to make the rounds and see all of the churches, which is a big task because he has to cover Massachusetts, Connecticut, Rhode Island, or at least some of your colleagues do. And so we're glad to have you. I think he's going to come up and say a few words.
Good morning.
Good morning.
As your pastor said, my name is Reverend Isaac Lawson, and I am the South Central Area Conference Minister for the Southern New England Conference of the United Church of Christ. And I wanted to first bring you greetings today on behalf of the Southern New England Conference and the Farmington Valley Association, of which your church is a member. And I do want to first stop to thank Reverend Zach. Reverend Zach, for the invitation today. I was actually scheduled to be here with you all this summer, and I failed to get the correct summer time, and so your pastor offered me some grace and invited me back. So here I am. As he said, I'll also get a chance to work with him and see him at work with the Committee on Ministry, of which he is the chair of the Committee on Ministry. And so I'm so grateful and thankful for him to be able to witness his leadership, his kindness, and just humility and dedication. So like I said, not only to this church, but to all of the churches in the association, as well as the authorized ministers and clergy. So I just want to publicly say thank you to your pastor for that work that he does. Terryville Congregational, as your area conference minister, please know that I am not only a resource to you, but also a covenant partner with you, along with the Farmington Valley Association in mission and ministry. And why do I say this? I simply say this to remind you all that you are indeed not alone. There are 13 congregations in the Farmington Valley Association, nearly 100 congregations in the South Central region, and just shy of 600 congregations in the whole conference. So, beloved, you are indeed not alone. Therefore, I offer these words to you. Be the church boldly, knowing that you not only have the support of the conference and the association, but also the love of God, the example of Jesus, and the sustaining power of the Holy Spirit at work with you. So again, beloved, be the church boldly. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
And I think Reverend Isaac is going to join us at least briefly over at the picnic and get an opportunity to see Pastor Denise and the other pastors that will be there. So that will be wonderful. Announcements from the congregation. I think we're going to pass the microphones. Ruth?
I was really shocked last week. My daughter, Joyce, and her husband, John, are selling their house in Bellington. It's right out of Crystal Lake. Oh. And they're moving to the Lake George.
Oh.
So the house is going on sale in October. But she'll be here for my birthday, so that's good. But I left them all many years ago and did what I wanted to. So they've always wanted to live on Lake George. So prayers for them that everything goes smooth.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
Reminder for our food pantry, please keep it in mind, you know, check your pantry and see if there's something you'd like to donate. If God's blessed you, let's bless our community. And thank you all for supporting the community garden, and we still have tomatoes coming. Hopefully we'll all see at the all church picnic this afternoon.
Whenever you see that red wagon, that is our reminder to bring in our donations for the food pantry. So we thank you. I see quite a few bags in there. We appreciate that. Wayne?
Prayers for Maya, Jesus' grandson. He had his second and third brain operations this week. His first brain operation 2 months ago was to relieve some pressure on his brain from a mass that was causing him to have headaches. Now the most recent hospitalization is for he was having seizures, and they're trying to correct that. So prayers for him and his family, and hopefully he had a rough night the first night after the second operation. But as of yesterday, he was starting to improve, continue improving for him.
Yes. Other announcements or prayer requests?
I wanted to thank everybody for the prayers that you had said for my friend Cindy. She did lose her battle with cancer in August, and I'm asking if you could pray for her family. Even though they were prepared, they really weren't prepared. So if you could please keep Cindy's family in your prayers. And our friend Jerry suffered a stroke a week ago, right before he was going to be moving into his new home. So if you could keep Jerry in your prayers, I'd appreciate it. And next Saturday at the Mum Festival, Gary and I will be there with our pirate ship, and we'll be collecting non-perishable food items for Brian's Angels. They're having a really difficult time as well keeping their food supply going. So if you have nothing to do from noon to 6, come down to the boulevard and bring something to put in the treasure chest for Brian's angels. Thank you.
Thank you. If you will, on my way here, I learned from a friend that his father just passed. So for Angelo and the passing of his father.
You'll see our upcoming events and other announcements on the back of your bulletin, as well as our full prayer list. I mentioned the mission trip briefly earlier. Yesterday we had a nice opportunity. Peggy graciously hosted us at her house, everybody that went on the trip that was able to make it. And we had like a little reunion gathering. It was really nice. And a week from today, next Sunday, we're going to do a full presentation. We wanted to wait. We could have done it in the summer, of course, but we wanted to wait until we're back into a full schedule here. So please make plans to be here next Sunday. We're going to show a full slideshow, and we're going to do a full talk about our experience in Kentucky, and we're looking forward to that. Let us worship God. That is why we are here. I think it's so important. I said this often. In the midst of our busy lives, to remember why we are here. So I invite you to take a deep breath. Whatever your brain is busy with this morning, whether it's your grocery list or something coming up in your week this week, or some errands you need to do, or whatever it is, try to let it go, or at least place it in a little imaginary box and put it to the side for a while. And let us focus on our relationship with God and bowing before God, starting from a place of gratitude and being in the spirit of worship. Join with me in our unison call to worship, which is from Psalm 54. Save me, O God, by your name, and vindicate me by your might.
Hear my prayer, O God.
Give ear to the words of my mouth.
For the insolent have risen against me.
The ruthless seek my life. They do not set God before them.
But surely God is my helper.
The Lord is the upholder of my life. And let us sing together the red hymnal number 66.
Thank you.
to God in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we come before you this morning, and as we always do, we start with gratitude. Many of us live very busy, very layered lives. In the midst of our comings and our goings, often, when we're not intentional, we neglect simply to be thankful. We want to carve out space this morning to come to you, to bow before you, to worship you, and to say thank you. Every gift in our life is of you and from you. We are so thankful to have this church, to have this community, to have a whole group of churches that are going to come together after worship today in a beautiful spirit of unity and have food and fellowship together. We're thankful that we have our families and our friends. We're thankful that we woke up this morning and we're able to come to church and we're here. We're thankful that we can say our prayers to you. And we are thankful that we know you hear us. We believe in the power of prayer. Be with us this morning, O God, as we worship you. Send your Holy Spirit into our lives and speak to us the words that you want us to hear. Direction and guidance for our lives. Help with life's difficulties and challenges. And the people that are on our hearts this morning, embrace them with your warmth and your love. Those situations that we're thinking about, maybe we're trying to make an important decision, or maybe something's going on at our job, or something's going on at home, or something's going on in the neighborhood, and we're looking for help. We're looking for strength. We're looking for some guidance. Help us to be patient when we seek you in prayer. And help us also to be persistent in our prayers. As we sing together today, as we pray together, as we hear scripture, hold us in the palm of your hand, remind us of your love for us, and at the same time, remind us of your call to us to be servants, to be followers of our Savior, Jesus Christ. And we ask all these things in his name. Amen. At this time, I'd like the students to come forward and join me. Good morning. You know what this means, right? Some of you do that have been here and seen this before. I heard a few groans when I asked them if they remembered this. This is what we call pastor pockets. And in these pockets, I've got different little items that I'd like to share with you today. Let's see which one I want to bring up first. First, I got this. This is when I tell a good joke, I can give a little. I'll let Peggy be there. You know, some of these you might have seen before, but it's been a while, so I'm gonna reacquaint us with them, okay? You know, sometimes you just want like a little bit of coffee, you know? Instead, you ask for half a cup of coffee. Yes, these are groaners. They're groaners on purpose. I was really, even though I don't have much hair right now, sometimes I have a lot of hair, and I really needed like a good like hair dryer. Let's see what else I got here. Hold on. Oh. This is very special. What was the groan? I heard. Oh. Was Did I hate this one? You remember? You remember this one? I knew I had won my wife over because I got her a diamond pin. It's a dime and a pin. Now, let me find the main one I want to show you today. I'm really hoping that you're all going to go to the picnic. Let me make sure. Sometimes it falls apart. It fell apart. No! I'm gonna come. The more you groan, the more this thing is coming out. Alright. I'm gonna show it to you anyway. Please come to the picnic after. It's right down the road that way, like 3 miles maybe, something like that. And you can't miss it because you just go down, find the big white church, and we're outside on the lawn. We got a lot of hot dogs and hamburgers. And this used to have a quarter on it, and it was a quarter pounder. But the quarter fell off. But I'm going to be there grilling you some quarter pounders, not the McDonald's kind, the Reverend Zach kind. Okay? So please come there after, and we're going to have fellowship together. It's a beautiful day, and we're going to kick off this new Sunday school year together. I understand that Charlie's mom is not feeling well today, unfortunately. So confirmation class, we're going to just all go to the picnic today for confirmation class because she's our confirmation teacher. And then next Sunday, our confirmation class is going to be kicking off here after church. Okay? So you're going to have a good Sunday school, good picnic. We'll take our offering, and then we'll have a prayer together.
Century tradition of depicting paradise. Its lyrics contrast the difficulties on earth with the tranquility of heaven. The hearer is invited to think in the long term, all is well, because God is alive.
did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him, and 3 days after being killed, he will rise again. But they did not understand what he was saying, and were afraid to ask him. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, What were you arguing about on the way? But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another, who was the greatest? He sat down on the 12 and said to them, Whoever wants to be the first must be the last of all servant, all and servant to all. Then he came and he took a child, put it among them, and taking in his arms, he said to them, Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me.
The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray. God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable unto you. You are our strength and you are our Redeemer. Amen. I have to tell Reverend Isaac here that we always start the sermon with jokes. And kind of like Pastor Pockets, they're rather corny. So does anybody have any humor that you've been wanting to share? Say at least one hand.
The three most troubling words, do not touch, especially for those who are reading it in Braille.
Wait, what? I missed it. What do you call a what?
A hen looking at lettuce.
A hen looking at lettuce.
Chicken Caesar salad.
Chicken Caesar salad. I got a lot today.
Actually, I sent this to Reverend Zach over the summer, so I don't know if I'm repeating it. What happens to bad rainbows? They get sent to prison. But don't worry, it was a light sentence.
Yeah, that's a good one. I got a few that were handed to me already here. Why should you not put a fan on its back? It'll blow up. Okay, I bought a wall calendar, but discovered it was missing an entire page. It skipped straight from the fourth month to the sixth month. Needless to say, I was dismayed. What sounds like a sneeze and is made of leather? A shoe. What did the band leader call his twin daughters? Anna 1, Anna 2. Did you know people who are late are often happier than those who have to wait for them? That was pretty true. Don't tell secrets in the garden, because the potatoes have eyes, the corn has ears, and the beanstalk. Corny. Yeah, Reverend Isaac, I often say it's so important. Our lives sometimes are burdened, and there can be a heaviness there. So it's nice to be able to know that we can take a deep breath, and have a little lightness. Even if the jokes aren't truly hilarious, even in your groaning, it kind of at least can spark a smile. And I think that's important. I believe my mom used to always say, I believe in a lot of things that she often would say, and she would often say that God enjoys laughter, and that when we're laughing, God laughs with us. And that always meant a lot to me. She was a very humorous person. So I think about her a lot, and those words, which I think are very wise, that God laughs with us. So I want to talk a little bit about this lesson today, because as often happens in Jesus' travels and ministry, there's layers. There's layers here. You might read the lesson, or as Peggy read it, and the first thing you might notice is, oh, he picked up a child and said, you need to welcome the vulnerable. And he talked about, you know, the last will be first, the first will be last, and you need to really be servants. Don't be worried about who's the greatest, but instead be humble in yourselves, be servants. Realize that just when you think you're great is really perhaps when you might be last. And those who are vulnerable, we need to lift them up and welcome them and really show that we are being servants. So that's one layer. That's one layer. But there's some other layers going on too. For example, when the lesson first started, it said that Jesus was talking to them, but he was telling them not to tell anyone. And you hear that a lot, especially in Mark's gospel. Mark's gospel is of the four is the one that mentions that the most. Don't tell anyone. And people often ask me, why would Jesus say that? It seems odd that he would say, don't tell anybody. I mean, he's trying to get the word out, and hey, has this ministry and this message. There's a few reasons there, I think. One of them is he knew that there was a timeline to his ministry. So part of it is, I know that I have this mission on earth, and there's a timeline to it. And I don't necessarily want it to speed up. So kind of keep it a little quiet. Having said that, though, he knew they were going to tell anyway. How would you not have this wonderful news of this person who's transforming your life and not going to go out and spread it? Of course they told him anyway, and he knew they would tell him anyway. Another reason, though, is I think he's trying to model exactly what he's talking about in the lesson. He's trying to model what it's like to be a servant. And usually servants don't go around sort of bragging on themselves and pat themselves on the back. So if he said, hey, I'm wonderful, go tell everybody I'm wonderful, it kind of goes against him modeling being a servant leader and being someone who's willing to bend down and wash people's feet, someone who's willing to welcome all, someone who opens his arms to all people, no matter who they are, where they're from. And so I always tell people, it's those three things that are going on here when he tells them not to tell people. It's he knows they're going to tell him anyway. He knows the message is going to get out. But he also knows there's a timeline involved. And also he wants to model. I don't want to tell you to go out and toot my own horn, because that's not modeling being a servant. That would be me sort of bragging about myself. So that's how it starts. That's another layer going on in this lesson today. But the one I've been thinking about the most, the layer that I've been thinking about the most as I've been sitting with this lesson, is the focus of the disciples. He has just told them something so powerful. He's told them he has to die, he's going to rise again. And then we're told that they didn't really understand it, but they were afraid to ask him about it. The focus of the disciples, where is their focus? And then they start traveling. What do? They make the focus about themselves. We're told that once they get to where they're going, they're like, what were you guys arguing about? And they're kind of embarrassed about it. Because they were arguing, I'm better. No, I'm better. I think Jesus likes me the best. No, I think he likes me the best. Well, I think I'm going to be first in heaven. No, I think I'm going to be first in heaven. There's so many things and so many places where their focus could be, but what do? They turn it on themselves. And I've been thinking about, here we are 2,000 plus years later from when this happened. We often do the same thing in our world, right? There's so many places where our focus could be, but how often do we just simply make the focus about us? And especially with since social media has been out, especially. Because that promotes you promoting yourself, right? It's a sort of a self. Now, I don't down social media. I tell people all the time, I think it's wonderful, especially for people like me who have a lot of out-of-state relatives. It's a wonderful way to stay in touch with out-of-state relatives and stuff like that. But it's also a tool, especially with our teenagers, that can be very dangerous because of self-image and all the things that it promotes on there. But here we are this many years later, and we still tend to make the focus on us. I mean, that's part of being human, right? It's just natural as human beings to do that. But I think Jesus wants us to dig a little deeper. And I was thinking to myself, there's so many things that those disciples could have done. They're just like us. We're just like them. We're no better than them. They're no better than us. And that's what makes them so relatable. I always tell people, read about Jesus' ministry, because in reading about his ministry, you find so much to relate to. And one thing we can relate to is the disciples, because we're the same way. We tend to focus on ourselves. They could have, in this scenario, said, can you tell us more about this whole death thing? That's one thing they could have done. Or they could have said, you know, those words are making us afraid. You're telling us about your death, that's scaring us. We just want to express to you that we're kind of scared now. They could have said that, or they could have said, we need to get to know you better, because this is new stuff you're telling us. We don't understand this, we just want to be close to you and get to know you. Or they could have said, hey, where are we going? Where's our next traveling taking? There's so many things they could have done, right? but instead, very easily, it turns to the self. And so I want to encourage us all, just like those disciples are, in a lot of ways, to be human is to have that sort of tendency to focus on the self, but to ask yourself in any situation, where is my focus? Where is my focus? Whether it be, let's say you've got a situation going on at work. Before diving into handling the situation, pause, take a breath, say a little prayer, and then ask yourself, where is my focus in this situation? Or maybe something's going on at home. Before you dive into it, pause, say a little prayer, ask yourself, where is my focus in this situation? No matter what is going on in your life, try to take that pause, try to say a little prayer, and ask yourself, where is my focus? I think if we can make our focus more about God, amazing things can happen. It is natural as humans to focus on the self, but let's try to pause a little. Let's try to take those breaths. One of the things I'm finding is that the world's getting busier and busier and busier, more and more layered. We got news coming at us 24/7. We got, you know, people telling us things 24/7. You can't get away from sort of the noise of it all. And sometimes in that busyness, it creates sort of a rushing mentality. And when you add to that, something I talk about a lot, instant gratification, when you add the busyness, the rushing, and then instant gratification to it, what can happen sometimes is that we can rush into action. And sometimes those actions can be unhealthy because in our rushing, we made it about us. So I just want to encourage us to pause a little. I have this thing on my office door that some of you might have seen. Because I'm guilty of this too. People always say to me after church, not always, but sometimes, that was a good sermon. I can relate to it so much. You know what I say to them? I say the things I need to hear. Anytime I'm telling you something, it's because I need to hear it too. And I'm going through my week and I'm thinking, what do I need to work on? I need to work on this. All right, that's going to be my sermon. Because we're all human. We're all the same in a lot of ways. So when I'm telling you this stuff, it's something I need to work on too. I have this little saying I keep on my office door, not that I live into it perfectly, but I'm trying. And it says, I'm not going to get the exact quote right, but it's something like this. I often thought I could rush around and handle everything. But what I realized is that I was doing that, but I was doing it shallowly. And so what I'm trying to do now is live a life of depth versus a life of breadth. In other words, yeah, you could probably rush around and handle it all, but how deeply are you going to be able to do that? Versus pausing, focus on the thing that's the most important, and maybe you'll be able to do that thing a little deeper. And now think about how that might apply to your life and the situations that you're facing. Maybe you've got a lot on your plate. Well, that's the time, I think, to pause, to say a little prayer, and to ask ourselves, where's my focus? Is the focus on me? How might I make the focus be a little bit more about God? And now that I've gone through that little series of questions, now let me look back at this plate of things that's in front of me. And let me strive for that life of depth versus handling as much as I can handle, but handling it all very shallowly. So important in our lives. We're living in a society that is rushed, busy, and instant gratification. And if you try to apply that to your faith, it doesn't work. The life of faith is a life of depth. And in that depth, we have to pause. We have to ask ourselves, how can I seek a closer relationship with God? Look at the disciples. There's so many avenues they could have gone in this lesson. Hey, we're scared. Hey, can you tell us more about your death and resurrection? Hey, where are we going next? Hey, what's the next mission or ministry task that we're doing? Hey, we love you. We want to get to know you better. Hey, can you be near us? You've transformed our lives. We love you. We want to be close to you. Hey, how can we build a better relationship with you? They didn't take any of those paths. They took the, hey, which one of us is the best? Typical. We're the same. But it doesn't mean we always have to remain that way. We can work on it one step at a time. We'll never perfect it. We're humans. But can we work on it? Can we every day, every moment, think about the things going on in your life? Where might we pause? Where might we say a little prayer? And where might we ask, where's my focus? And how can I make my focus more on God? On a closer relationship with Jesus Christ. I think he was telling him he was going to die and rise again to say, we've got to build this relationship up because some stuff's going to be happening. And it's going to be major. It's something the world's never seen before. And I think he's saying the same thing to us even though it's 2,000 plus years later. I think he's saying, I want to be in your life. I have my arms open to you. But if you're rushing around and making everything about yourself, there's no room for me. So how might you make some room for me? I think he said. He said, I always have room for you. I'm open arms. But how might you make some more room for me? Amen. Let's sing just about that same topic here. Nearer, my God, to thee.
Thank you.
seek a closer relationship with you. Help us in the situations we face, whether it be at work, at home, in the neighborhood, in the grocery store, wherever we are, to place our focus on you. Show us the way. Remind us that you have sent your Son Jesus into the world, and yes, he has died, and yes, he has risen, and yes, he has ascended to you, and yes, we have the gift of the Holy Spirit, which means we have the tools we need, the gifts from you, to be able to take our lives one moment at a time, and to know that we're not alone, to know that we're forgiven, to know that we have your grace, to know that you abide. We want to name to you all the people who are on our hearts. We've named a lot of them earlier, and we want to lift them up to you. We ask that you be with Lauren, be with Cindy's family, be with Wayne's niece's grandson, and be with Jerry, be with Ruth's daughter and family as they make their transition. Be with Angelo's family. Be with all those on our prayer list. Be with all of our area churches. Be with us as we come together this afternoon. And as we always do, we have other thoughts and prayers in our hearts this morning. We want to take time to lift them up to you. And we will do that with a moment of silence. And let us pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us respond to God's love and God's word in our lives as we receive this morning's offering. Thank you.
Amen.
And let us sing together number 19 in the blue book. Love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you today and always.